sequences and series. Sequences and series. Okay? I'm sure most of you would be doing this chapter in school or would have done this chapter in school. If you've done this chapter in school, how did you find it? Easy, moderate, difficult? Easy, okay. Easy, Shashwat, not good. Okay. By the way, many books will also call this chapter as progressions and summations. Progressions and series. Okay. Series or summations, whatever you call it. Fine. So I'm getting a mixed response. People found it easy, some people found it not that good. Okay, anyways. Before I start this chapter, since you have done this in school, I would like you to answer me a simple question. What do you think is the difference between sequence, a progression, and a series? I would love to hear from you. Since you have done this chapter in school, what according to you is the difference between these three terms? Are they the same? Right? Or they're different? If they're different, how they're different? Anybody? If you want, you can speak out also. What is the difference between sequence, progressions, and series? Progression, there is a common difference. Okay. Sequence is like AP. Okay. Okay. So if I ask you, what is a human being? Human being is like Akhil. Is that how you will answer, Vaibhav? Sequence is a pattern. Sequence is a bunch of numbers following a rule. Okay, predefined rule. Progression is change. Sequence is any random collection of terms. Okay. So any random collection of terms will become a sequence. Wow. Okay. Series is a sum of a sequence. Okay, now I'm getting mixed response from people. Okay, some of your arguments are correct, some of your arguments are not. Okay, now let me take this over. Okay. Thank you for your opinion. Love to see your responses. See, sequence is a listing of numbers. It could be alphabets or letters. It could be phrases. Okay. Where there is a pattern or a rule, a well-defined pattern or a rule. Okay. It cannot be random. Okay, there has to be a rule or a pattern, then only we'll call a sequence. I don't know how many of you have written NTSC. In NTSC, there was a segment called mental ability test. In mental ability test, the very first chapter is sequence. Okay, so you have to find out the next letter in the sequence or next number in the sequence, or for that matter, next word on the sequence, right? So sequence is a listing where there is a pattern or a rule hidden. That's how we can find out a subsequent term of a sequence. Okay. Progression is a sequence. So progression is what? It's a type of a sequence where there is an explicit formula. There is an explicit formula to find the value of the next term, or to find, oh sorry, I'm writing it twice, to find the value of a term from its position. Now, what is the difference between these two? Let me give an example for this. Okay. Series I will come to in some time. I'll just give the example and cite the difference between them. See, let's say I give you a listing like this: 2, 3, 5, 7, 9, 11, 13, 17, 19, 23, da 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 da. Okay? I'm sure you would have recognized this. What is this? This is a sequence of prime numbers, right? Absolutely, Gayatri. But we'll not call it as a progression because there is no formula for finding the value of a prime number given its position is known. For example, if I say, give me 8,764th prime number, will you be able to find it out? Does there any formula exist which will tell you that, okay, if you put the position of that prime number will throw out the value of that prime number. Is there any formula where I'll put, let's say, 5 and I should get, for writing a 9, okay. Let's say if I put a 5, I'll get a 11. Is there any formula like that? Or if I put, let's say, 10, I should get something like 23, or let's say the next prime number is 29. Okay, will I get like that? There is no such formula. So we will call this as a sequence of prime numbers, not as a progression of prime numbers. So this is an example of a sequence of prime numbers. Okay. So there is no explicit formula by which we can know the value of a prime number given its position is known to us. But what is a progression? Progression, on the other hand, is those sequences. For example, if I write something like this, 1, 4, 7, 10, 13, 16, Now, in this also, there is a pattern, but I know that there is a formula for the nth term, which in this case is 3n minus 2. Okay. So if I put n as 1, I'll get the first term. If I put n as 2, I will get the second term. If I put n as 3, I'll get the third term. If I put n as 4, I'll get the fourth term. So there exists a formula by which I can generate the value of a term if I know its position. So such sequences will be called as a progression. Right? Now somebody who said there is a common difference. See, those are all very limited examples you are giving. Progression is a much broader term. You could have a geometric progression. You could have a harmonic progression. You could have an arithmetico-geometric progression. Right? So it's not only about common difference only. The main criteria for you to call a sequence as a progression is that there should be a formulation for finding out the value of a term given its position is known. In sequence, such formulations may not be present. Okay. So by this logic, you would have understood that sequence is a bigger set. And within that bigger set, there is a set of progression. Okay. So let's say this red circle represents sequences. Then this yellow circle will represent progressions. So progressions are types of sequences. Okay. All sequences formulation is not possible. But yes, there is a pattern hidden in it. In progressions, there is a formulation hidden. Okay. Now just a small question for you. 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 21, Okay. Have you heard of this listing before? See the wrong use of word. Fibonacci series. It's not a series. For sure. It is a Fibonacci sequence. Correct? Is it eligible to be called a progression? Yes, because there is a formulation made for Fibonacci sequence, okay? And that is called the Binet's formula. I would request everybody to search it out. Wikipedia, YouTube, whatever sources you can, Google it out. There is a formula. No, this is not a formula. This is a relation. This is a pattern, Anurag. Anurag is mentioning this. Anurag, this is a pattern by which it is built up. But there is a formula for finding the nth term. Figure it out, okay? It has some got irrational terms. 1 plus root 5 by 2, etc. will be there. That formula is called the Binet's formula. So this is actually qualifying to be called as a Fibonacci progression also. Right? But mostly people who do not know this formula, they play a safe hand. They say Fibonacci sequence. But Anurag, not series, my dear. Okay? So what is series? Series is when you add terms of a sequence. So series is a summation. So when you add terms of a sequence, that becomes a series. Okay. So when sequence terms are added up, you can say subtracted also. See, subtraction is a special form of adding, of negative terms, right? So sequence, when they're added, that will be series. So don't interchangeably use these words. Please do not interchangeably use this word. Who is spamming? Pranav. No permutation of ways of adding 1 and 2 to get. I didn't get that. No permutation or number of permutation? I didn't understand that at all. Oh, camera is on. Sorry for that. My daughter. Yes. Pranav, I didn't understand what you meant to say by that line. Okay. Anyways, is the difference clear now? See, guys, whenever you're talking to, you know, people who are have a bit of knowledge in maths, please use proper words, right? Don't say Fibonacci series for it. I know many people are using wrong words, right? This is not a series. Unless until you add them, it is not a series. Okay. Not all sequences are progressions. However, you can use sequences for progressions also. That's why this chapter name is sequences and series, because progressions are types of sequences only. But remember, all sequences need not be formalized. They may not have a formula in place. Okay. Anyways, so with this knowledge, we will understand what are we going to study in this chapter. So let me give you an overview. Okay. In this chapter, we are going to first talk about three different types of progressions. Okay, we are going to talk about three different types of progressions. What are they? Arithmetic progression, which is something you have already done in your class 10th. And you have all done exceedingly well in this chapter, because this is supposed to be a very easy chapter. You will be introduced to geometric progression. Geometric progression. Okay. And there will be one more type of progression called the harmonic progression, which is not there in your school syllabus. So if your school teacher would have taught you this chapter, she would not have touched upon harmonic progression, because this is not a part of your CBSE curriculum. Second thing that we are going to learn in this chapter is the concept of means. Okay. So three types of means will be there: arithmetic mean, geometric mean, harmonic mean. You have already heard of these terms. We have done a few of the concepts prior to this by use of the relationship between AM, GM and HM. Okay. And very importantly, the relationship between AM, GM and HM. The inequality between, or people call it as AM, GM inequality. Let me write it like that only. AM, GM, AM, GM, HM inequality. Okay. Sir, will you be teaching harmonic progression? Yes, why not? That's why I'm listing it out. It is nothing. It's very small. It's just 15 minutes concept. Okay. Third thing that we are going to talk about is your series. Series. So in series, what are we going to learn? We are going to primarily learn methods of summation. Methods of summation. Okay. Under this, we are going to learn three concepts: sigma method of summation, method of difference, and under method of difference, we are going to specialize in one of the methods called the VN method, VN method of summation. And second thing we are going to learn is your AGS. AGS. A stands for arithmetico. G stands for geometric, S stands for series. Okay. So this is our entire, you can say, the index or the content for this chapter. It should not take us more than two classes. Okay. Two classes or slightly more than two classes. So we'll be able to finish it off. Meanwhile, I would also like to discuss with you. So let's start with arithmetic progression. Now this concept is quite well known to you all. So I'll be fast here so that we save a lot of time. In fact, we'll spend time doing some questions. So what is an arithmetic progression? It's a sequence where a subsequent term differs from the preceding by a common difference. Okay. So the subsequent term differs from the preceding by a common difference. That means your n plus 1th term differs from your nth term, or for that matter, you can say It's fine. N plus 1 is also fine. This difference is always fixed. So any kind of a sequence which meets this criteria would be eligible to call as a, this is the pattern that that particular sequence is following, right? So this is the pattern. Now, why am I calling it as a progression? Is there a formula possible for nth term or n plus 1 term? Let's see. So there are two ways you can figure out the formula. One way is, if you see, this is your first term. This is your second term. This is your third term. This is your fourth term. Are you able to relate the position with the number of d's that you have here? For example, if there is first term, there is no d, or you can say 0d. There is second term, there is 1d. Third term, 2d. Fourth term, 3d, right? So by looking at it, you can say that for your nth term, there will be a plus n minus 1d. And there you go. This is your formulation, or this is your formula for your nth term of this particular sequence. And hence, this sequence qualifies to be called as a progression. Now, this is by observation. Let's say somebody says, sir, I don't want to observe and give the formula. Can we use this pattern to come with a formula? Yes, that is very simple. Start putting some values of n over here. Let's say I put n as 1. If I put n as 1, I get t2 minus t1 as d. If I put n as 2, what do I get? t3 minus t2 as d. If I put 3, what do I get? t4 minus t3 as d. If I keep on going and put finally your n value as n minus 1, I will get tn minus tn minus 1 as d. Let's add them all. If you add them, on the left hand side, you would realize that there would be a cancellation of these terms happening. Okay. As a result, you will be left with tn and t1. And you would write d, 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 how many times? N minus 1 times. Remember, you started with 1 and you went till n minus 1, right? So your tn will be t1, which you already know is a, n minus 1d. So this is another way to get to the formula for the nth term of an arithmetic progression, right? This is already well known to you. Okay. Let's directly jump to questions, because I think most of you are already aware of these. So time to take a small quick question on this. Let's take a question. Okay. I'll start with this question. Consider two arithmetic progressions, S1 and S2. S1 has terms like 2, 7, 12, 17, da 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 da, till 500 terms. S2 has 1, 8, 15, 22, da 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 da, till 300 terms. There are two parts to this question. One is find the number of common terms. That's the first part. Second part is what is the last common term? What is the last common term? I would request everybody to use their last year experience. And of course, this year also you have done it. I'm sure you will get this right. So I want two answers. What is the number of common terms? And what is the last term? So in your chat box, your answer should look like two numbers separated by comma. Don't give me a single answer, okay? I want the number of common terms and I want the last term, okay? Let's have around 2.5-3 minutes. I think that is good enough for time. Come on, guys. First question. Chalo, izzat ka sawal hai. Isko karna kya hai? Let's do it. Aditya, give me two answers. Okay. Good. Okay, Aditya. Okay, let's discuss this, guys. I think it has been quite a while now. So let's write down these terms. 1, 7, 12, 17, 22, 27, da 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 da. Okay, now I would like to check whether the 500th term of the first series is less or whether the 300th term of the second series, second sequence is less. Sorry for using the word series. Second sequence is less. Okay. So let's figure out what is the 500th term of the first sequence. So here, the sequence is basically following a arithmetic progression. The first term is 2. Common difference is 5. So 500 minus 1 into 5. I think this will give you 2500 minus 3, right? It's 2497. Okay, so the 500th term is 2497. And for the second sequence, this is your S1. For the second sequence, let's check 1, 8, 15, 22. I think it's a common difference of 7. So next term will be 29. Da, 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 da. 300th term. What is the 300th term in this particular sequence? So n, sorry, a plus n minus 1. N minus 1 is 300 minus 1. Into d. D is 7. So this is going to be 2100 minus 6, which is 2094. Okay, so guys, we have now first figured out that, okay, this guy is the smaller of the two. Okay, this guy is the lesser of the two. So nowhere, no way I can exceed this number. Okay, anyways, now if I start finding out which is the first common term, the first common term you can see is 22. Okay, so if I start making a sequence of the common terms, the first common term will be 22. Can somebody tell me when will be the next common term occurring, or what should be the, you know, difference between the next term and this term? Any idea? 35, absolutely. So the next term will occur at an LCM of 5 and 7. Okay, see, it's like saying that there are two bells in your school, let's say. One bell is ringing after every 5 minutes. One bell is ringing after every 7 minutes. If, let's say, both of them ring now, when will they ring next? They will ring next after a gap of, which is a LCM of 5 and 7. LCM of 5 and 7 is 35. We all know that. So the next term will be 57. Okay. Again, next term will be 92, like that. But remember, whatever terms I get, this term must be less than or equal to 2094. Right? So let's figure it out. So Tn should be less than equal to 2094. Let's see where all we can go. So that n will give me the number of common terms. So 22 plus n minus 1 into 35 is less than equal to 2094. So n minus 1 into 35 is less than 2072. So n minus 1 by 35 will give me, or you can say this will give me a number less than 2072 by 35. This is very close to 60. I think it's 59 point something. So n minus 1 is less than 59 point. Let's say, how much is this? 59, 9.2. Okay. So n is less than 60.2. So your n being a natural number can only be 60. So absolutely correct, Janta, who said there will be 60 common terms. And let's find out what will be that last term common. So the last term common will be 22 plus n minus 1 into 35. Okay, how much is this? 35 into 6 gives me 210. 210 means 2100. Minus 13, I believe. So this is 2087. So this is your last common term. Aditya Adrija, I don't know how are you getting 2062. Both of you counted it wrong. Okay. Is it fine? Any questions? Silly mistake, Adrija also. Okay, never mind. Let's move on to the next concept immediately. I don't want to waste time. Sum of n terms of an AP. So before we start this process, I would like to tell you a small story, a small inspiring story. Okay. There was a small chap in Germany, I think a six-year-old boy in Germany, who was given a punishment by his school teacher to add up all natural numbers from 1 to 100. Okay. I don't know whether you have heard of this story. So six-year-old, seven-year-old probably, not more than that. And imagine a six-year-old guy given a task of adding numbers from 1 to 100. How painful it will be for the student, right? But this guy was very smart. What he did was, he wrote the same set of numbers in a reverse order. Something like this. Okay. And then he added both the series. So S plus S is 2S. And when he started adding these numbers, he realized that he's always getting 101. See? So when you're adding these, they're always giving you 101. Till the last number also 101. Okay. So he realized that, okay, he is writing 101 100 times. So this into 100. So his S was nothing but 101 into 100 by 2, which is nothing but 101 into 50. And he basically found out the answer in quick time, right? So his punishment that was given to him basically was no punishment for him. He actually could solve it in a, you know, minimal efforts. This guy later on went to become one of the greatest physicists and mathematicians of all times, Carl Friedrich Gauss. Carl Friedrich Gauss. I'm sure you would have heard of his name. Gauss. Gauss has given wonderful theorems in number theory. He has done a lot of work in the field of electrostatics. I think in class 12, Dheeraj sir will teach you about the Gauss theorem. Okay. So this guy later on went to become, see, 6-year-old guy doing this, right? You can well imagine how far he can think of. So the same concept that he used will be using also to find the sum of n terms of an AP. So why I told you this story is because I'll be using a similar concept to find out the sum of n terms of an AP. So let's say if you have an arithmetic series given to you like this. Now see, I'm using the word arithmetic series because I'm adding terms of an arithmetic sequence or arithmetic progression. Okay. So let's say I'm adding terms of this arithmetic progression from A to A plus N minus 1D. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to write the same in a reverse fashion. Okay. The second last term will be A. I think it's the last term actually. So I could just write an A. Okay. Now start adding the two series in this fashion. So add S and S, which is 2S. Add these two. You'll get 2A plus N minus 1D. Okay. Add these two. You will again get a 2A plus N minus 1D. You can check it out. Add these two. You will again get a 2A plus N minus 1D. And you will see that constantly your sum is fixed at 2A plus N minus 1D. Okay. So how many 2A plus N minus 1Ds have you written on the right side? N number of 2A plus N minus 1Ds, right? Correct. So this makes our life very easy. So the sum till N terms will be nothing but N by 2, 2A plus N minus 1D. And this is the formula that you have actually learned in your class 10th also to find this. Okay. Now I have another method to do this. We'll try to figure out the same formula by another method. Okay. So first make a note of this. Oh, that method I will talk about later, little later on. Don't worry. Okay. As of now, let's keep this as our method. That method we'll talk about when I'm doing series. Else there will be a repetition of concepts. Now, there are a lot of takeaways from this formula. It's not like, you know this formula and we know everything about it. No, there are a lot of takeaways from this formula. And those are very important takeaways. The first takeaway, I don't know how many of you observed, is when you add the first and the last term, it is the same as the sum of second and the second last term. It is the same as the sum of third and the third last term, and so on. What does it mean? It means that in an arithmetic progression, the sum of terms equidistant from the beginning and the end. Guys, the sum of terms equidistant from the beginning and the end. That means kth term from the beginning and kth term from the end will add up to give you the same value as the first and the last term. Right? K could be any number from 1 to n. Right? So this is a very, very integral property of an arithmetic progression. Every arithmetic progression will satisfy this. Sum of the terms equidistant from beginning and the end will be same as the sum of the first and the last term. Okay. And if at all there is a middle term, it will be twice of the middle term. Okay. I'll give you an example for this. Let's say I take a simple one, 1, 3, 5, 7, 9. Okay. Let me take more, 11, 13. Okay. 1 plus 13 will be same as 3 plus 11, will be same as 9 plus 5, will be same as twice of 7, or 7 plus 7, you can say. Okay. Double of middle term is what? Adding the middle term to itself. Okay. This is a characteristic satisfied by all arithmetic progressions. Okay. Hence, we say that if we have three terms in arithmetic progression, then A plus C will be twice of the middle term. Okay. So A plus C will become 2B. This is something that you have already been using in 10th also quite a lot. Okay. Second important takeaway point is, if at all this is the case, I can always write this term as, or sum of n terms as, not only this, we can also write it like sum of the first and the last term into n by 2, because this is actually made up of a and a plus n minus 1d. So this is your t1 and this is your tn. You can also write it as t2 plus tn minus 1. You could also write it as t3 plus tn minus 2. Correct? You can also write it as tkth term from the beginning and kth term from the end. Is this fine? Any questions regarding this? I'm sure you would have already known this fact, but the second fact is very important and some questions have been made on this. Any sequence whose sum till n terms is a quadratic in n of this nature will always represent a arithmetic progression. Please note this down. Okay. But if your series is like this, it will not be an arithmetic progression. Let me write AP only. Guys, this is very critical. Why it is critical? I'll tell you. See, we had derived this formula a little while ago, right? Okay. Now, many people, when I ask them, what kind of an expression is this in n? They will say, sir, it is a quadratic in n. Agreed. Absolutely no problem with that particular statement. But this is a quadratic where there is no constant term involved. So many a times, this observation is not done by students. So a question may come in the exam. There is a series which satisfies this kind of a relation for the sum of that particular sequence. Will that sequence qualify to be called an arithmetic progression? For this, the answer is yes. For this, the answer is no. Unless until your C becomes zero. But if you, let's say, A, B, C are non-zero quantities, then this will not be qualified to be called an arithmetic progression. Right? In an arithmetic progression, the sum of the terms will always be a quadratic in N without a constant term. This is very important. Constant term should not be there. Are you getting my point? I'll give you an example. Your space is not there. Okay, I'll give you here. So let's say I give you that there is a sequence. By the way, this is a notation for sequence. I don't know people who are prepared for Olympiads and all. This is a notation that we use for sequence. Okay. So this sequence sum is given by, let's say, n squared plus n plus 1. My question is this sequence an arithmetic progression? Now, I know people will say, sir, let's find out the terms. Apne aap pata chal jayega. Correct? But that will take time, isn't it? For example, let's say if I want to find out the first term. First term is what? S1 only. So that will be 3. Okay. Second term will be what? Second term will be S2 minus S1. Yes or no? S2 minus S1 will give you the second term. S2 is what? I think 4 plus 2, 6. 6 plus 1, 7. 7 minus 3, which is going to be 4. T3 will be what? T3 will be S3 minus S2. Okay. S3 will be what? 9 plus 3, 12. 12 plus 1, 13. 13 minus 2, which was 7, which is 6. Okay. Here itself, you can see that now the difference here was 1. Now the difference has become a 2. Right? So by doing all these things, you realize that, boss, this is not the sum of an AP. Okay. But the moment I say there is a sequence whose sum of n terms is n squared plus n, is this a arithmetic progression? Immediately you can say, yes, it is. Has to be. Okay, you can check it out. T1 will be whatever, or you can say, let's say T dash, I'm writing. T dash 1 will be what? 2. Correct? T dash 2 will be what? Put a 2 here and subtract a 2. So 2 here will be 4 plus 2, so it will be 4. Okay. T dash 3 will be what? Put a 3 here and subtract 6. So you'll get 9 plus 3, 12. 12 and minus 6. 12 minus 6 is 6. Yes, you can directly see that it is coming out to be an AP. It's coming out to be an AP. So in nutshell, what did I want it to convey? I wanted to convey here is the fact that if the sum of a given sequence, or you can say the sum of a series, is given to you as a quadratic without a constant, you can immediately go for the fact that it would represent an AP. But if the sum of a sequence or a series is given to you whose sum is containing a quadratic with a non-zero constant term, immediately you can reject that it is not an AP. Don't waste a single minute also on that. Is this fine? Any question, any concerns, do highlight. No questions? Okay. So if you don't have a question, let's solve questions. Okay. Here you go. As my first question. The sum of n terms of two APs are in this ratio. What is the ratio of their 24th term? Anurag, constant cannot be in terms of a changing thing. N is a changing. N is the number of terms. How can a constant be N? Constant means a fixed number. Find the ratio of the 24th terms of two APs. The ratio of whose sum till n terms is given to you as 3n minus 13 by 5n is plus 21. Come on, guys, you have done these kind of problems in class 10th. Remember your childhood days. When you were very small in class 10th. Jab main chota bachcha tha, bahut shararat karta tha. Yeah, 11, 12 is like totally different. And you know what? Just 1 year from now, you'll be filling the JEE form. 1 year is already gone. You're already almost completed class 11th. Time flies. And the sad part is we have not even got to see each other physically. I hope we get a chance to do so in this year. You can see me, right? I'm dancing on the camera only, but I have not got to see many of you. Done. Very good, Prateek. Very good, Aditya. Good, good, good. Anybody else? Anybody else? Okay, Anurag. Good. Let's try this out. See, let's say the sum till n terms of the first series is Sn and the sum of n terms of the second series is S dash n. Okay, they're two different APs. And let's say A is the first term and D is the common difference of the first sequence. And A dash is the first term and D dash is the common difference of the second. Very good, Adrija. N by 2 will go off. Okay. And this is given to us as 3n minus 13 upon 5n plus 12. 21, not 12. Okay. Now, what I'm going to do is I need the ratio of 24th term of both the sequences, right? So, what is T24 of an AP? A plus 23d. And this guy will be A dash plus 23d dash, isn't it? Okay. Now, how do I get this without knowing my A and B? So what I'm going to do is in this particular expression that I have, I'm going to divide this by 2. This also by 2. Note that I'm dividing by 2 both numerator and denominator, so it is not going to affect anything. So it's going to become something like this. Correct me if I'm wrong. Okay. And this is still 3n minus 13 by 5n plus 21. Now, if you try to compare this chap with this chap, you realize that if I replace my n minus 1 by 2 with 23, our work will be done, isn't it? So this ratio I could easily figure out, isn't it? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to substitute n minus 2 by 23. In short, I want to substitute n with 47. So A plus 23D, A dash plus 23D dash. Here also I'll substitute by 47. So 3 into 47 minus 13 upon 5 into 47 plus 21. Okay. I think it's an ugly value. How much is this? 141. 141 minus 13, 128. This is going to be 235. 235 plus 21, 256. Oh yes, answer is 1 by 2. Brilliant, Adrija. Very good. So Adrija, Aditya, Prateek. Prateek is back into action. Prateek, are you out of your hibernation? You are maintaining a very low profile from the last few classes. Okay, good. Let's move on to the next. I think we can take this question. Yeah. The question is the sum of the first, find the sum of the first 24 terms of an AP. A1, A2, A3, etc. If it is known that A1 plus A5 plus A10 plus A15 plus A20 plus A24 is 225. So you have been given a very, very, you can say, specific relationship between the terms, sum, and we know it's an AP. We have to find the sum of 24 terms. Could you go back for 1 second? Okay, after this problem, Anurag. Gayatri, very good. Excellent. Good, Pranav. Very good. You guys are right. Oh, you got it, Pranav. Good. Oh, sorry, Anurag. Very good, Pratik. Advik. Okay, now many of you would have actually substituted A5 as A1 plus 4D, A10 as A1 plus 9D, etc. And I'm sure you would have got the answer by that. But I would like to solve this problem in a slightly different way. Something which is related to the concept of the fact that the terms equidistant from the beginning and the end would be same as the sum of the first and the last term, right? So if you have, let's say, A1, that is the first term and the last term. Okay, this sum will be same as the sum of A5 and A20 because A5 is the fifth term from the beginning and A20 is the fifth term from the end. So these two will add up to give you the same thing. Similarly, A10 and A15 are 10th term from the beginning and 10th term from the end respectively. So they will also add up to give you the same thing, right? So the good part is, when they give this to you as 225, they have actually given you, let's say I call this as sum as x. So they have actually given you 3x is equal to 225. That means x is equal to 75, right? If you want the sum till 24 terms, you can directly use the fact that n by 2, sum of the first and the last term, which is 75, which is nothing but 12 into 75, 900. Is that clear? If you can tell me an easier way to solve this, I would be happy to accept it. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns, please do ask. Okay. So very strategically, they had given us such terms which were like equidistant from the beginning and the end. So first and the last, fifth and the fifth last, 10th and the 10th last. Okay. Find the middle term and multiply by n. Do you think, Pranav, that is a simpler way to solve it as compared to this? Okay, I said if you have a simpler way, do let me know. There are several ways to solve it, by the way. Okay, let's take another one. Let us take another one. Another one. Another one. Yeah. Okay. If n, the set of natural numbers, is partitioned into groups. Okay. So they have made sets out of it. S1 contains only 1, S2 contains 2 and 3, S3 contains 4, 5, 6, da 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 da. Find the sum of the numbers in S50. So if I continue making these partitions, I will reach S50. What will be the sum of elements of S50 is what they're asking us. Try this out. Take 2.5 minutes. I don't know why your school is conducting the exam so early. They should calibrate it with this year board, right? I don't know. They have their own management and policies. Aram said they could have conducted March end, no? I know that, Charan. Normally, all the schools have this, that they'll finish the syllabus by November. And after that, revision will happen and pre-boards, second pre-board, practicals, project submissions, lab records, all those things will start. So you all have to submit project reports, I believe, right? In all the subjects, including maths, start working on it. Lab record also, keep it up to date. Else what will happen? Last moment, you'll start, you know, copy pasting from your friends. And you start bunking school and classes for all those things. Don't do that. I know, Charan. So your exams will be offline, Gayatri. Gayatri, you come from which school? DPS? HL, okay. Okay, Pranav, good. Are you sure it is correct? Check, Mari. Okay, let's try to solve this problem. See here, if you see, keep observing these things. So there are something which is very, very interesting. If you see the last number of these sequence, sets, okay, you would realize that this one is one, of course. This three is actually 1 plus 2. Correct, Aditya? Correct, that's correct. This six is actually 1 plus 2 plus 3. Correct. So this gives you a lot of insight as to if I had gone till S50, and I would have written all the da-da-da-da-da-da elements in it, my last element would actually have been 1 plus 2 till 50. Correct? I mean, there are other elements also, which I will eventually find out, or you know, I will work around it, don't worry. But this guy would be the sum of all the numbers from 1 to 50. Correct? And we know the sum of numbers from 1 to 50 is 50 by 2, first term plus the last term, which is nothing but 25 into 51. How much is that? I think it's 1275. Correct? So this guy, at least you know, is going to be 1275. So the next guy would have been 1274, 1273. And you'll go on till, you'll go back by 50 terms, right? Okay, I don't need to write down what is the first term. Don't worry about it. So assume that you have a arithmetic progression over here, whose first term is 1275, second term is 1274, third term is 1273, da 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 da. In other words, the common difference is minus 1, Okay, so first term is 1275. Common difference is minus 1. Number of terms is 50. How do you find the sum of such a series? So the sum of such a series will be nothing but n by 2, 2a, n minus 1 into d. Okay, so I don't have to find which is the first term of that set. I don't need it. Whether you start from first to the last or last to the first, it is an AP. Of course, from first to the last, it is an increasing AP. Last to the first, it will be a decreasing AP. But nevertheless, it doesn't change our sum, isn't it? So this we can write it as 25 times. This is 12550 minus 49. So this is 25 times 2501, which is nothing but 62525. Well done, Aritra, Aditya. Good. You have got the answer for this. Nice. Is it fine? Any questions? Any questions? Any concerns? Any questions? No questions? All set? Sir, we thought we were good at this chapter, sir, but we are proven wrong. See, now you're good at the chapter, but now you're going to see different facets of problem solving involved, right? I agree with you that it's an easy chapter, but sometimes problems may become complicated. Okay, let's take this question. Before you start solving, a small correction I would like to make here. This is A4000. A1, A2, A3 till A4001 is in arithmetic progression such that 1 by A1, A2 plus 1 by A2, A3 and so on till 1 by A4000, A4001 is equal to 10. And it is also given to us that A2 plus A4000 is equal to 50. Find mod of A1 minus A4001. And let's have around three and a half minutes. Let me launch the poll for you. Time starts now. All right, 2 minutes gone. I have got two responses so far. Very good. One of the options is leading. All right, let's stop this in another 10 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay. Option B has got the most number of votes. Okay. Out of 10 people who voted, unfortunately only 10, 8 of you have said option number B. B for Bhatinda. Not every time Bengaluru only, huh? Bhatinda also. Okay, now see, let's use this information. How do we even start? That's what Anurag wants to know. Okay, Anurag, let's start. This is given to us as 10, right? Okay. Now what I'll do is I'll multiply this with a D, D being the common difference of this arithmetic progression. So let D be the common difference of this arithmetic progression. So I'll multiply this with D and I'll also multiply the numerators also with DDD. Okay. D. Okay. Now this D that you have, the first D, every D is different actually. Yeah? So pay attention. The first D is actually A2 minus A1. Okay. Second D is actually A3 minus A2. Okay. Third D is A4 minus A3. So as the number below it, I'm basically converting my D in that particular way. Okay. So this last D is A4001 minus A4000. Okay. Up till here, I don't think so anybody has any kind of a casta or a problem. Okay. If you have, do let me know. Now, first term over here, can I write it as 1 by A1 minus 1 by A2? Correct. Second term, 1 by A2 minus 1 by A3. Third term, 1 by A3 minus 1 by A4. Da-da-da-da-da. Till 1 by A4000 minus 1 by A4001. A4001. It is equal to 10D. Now these terms will start cancelling. Okay. Ultimately what will happen, everything will get cancelled except for 1 by A1 and 1 by A4001. And this is 10D for us. Okay. Let's write this in the form of a simplified expression. A1 into A4001 and numerator will be A4001 minus A1. That is equal to 10D. Now we all know that A4001, we all know that A4001 is A1 plus 4000D, isn't it? Because it's an arithmetic progression. So A4001 minus A1 is 4000D. So numerator will become 4000D. So I can write the same thing as 4000D by A1 A4001 as 10D. In other words, A1 A4001 is equal to 400. Let's call it as 1. Okay. Now A2 plus A4000 is 50. Now remember A2 plus A4000 is same as A1 plus A4001. So this will also be 50. Let's call it as second equation. Right? Now what do we have to find out? Nikalna kya hai? We have to find out this guy. Okay. So we have to find out modulus of A1 minus A4001. Okay. Let's say I call this as an X. Can I say X square is nothing but A1 minus A4001 square, which is actually A1 plus A4001 square minus 4A1 A4001. Basically, I use the formula A minus B whole square is A plus B whole square minus 4AB. And why did I choose to use this formula is because this term is known to us as 50. This term is known to us as 400. So 50 square minus 1600 will give you 900. So x square is 900. So x is 30. Please do not write minus 30 because x is a positive quantity. It's a positive quantity, as you can see. So only plus 30 will be the answer. So option number B, which most of you have answered with, absolutely correct option. Is it clear? Any questions? Any questions? Any concerns here? Anything you would like to ask from this solution? Okay, all fine. All right. So before we move any further, we'll talk about properties of an arithmetic progression. Properties of an arithmetic progression. The first property is the one which I've already discussed with you, that the terms equidistant from the beginning and the end is same as the sum of the first and the last term, and it is twice the middle term. This is already discussed, so just I'm mentioning it so that we don't forget about it. Second property is, if let's say A1, A2, A3, etc. Okay. Are in AP with common difference as D. With common difference as D. Then please note the following. Then number one, A1 plus or minus K, A2 plus or minus K, that means either you add or subtract a given constant K from these terms, it will still be in an AP. Okay. So if you have terms in an AP and you start subtracting a fixed number from all these terms, let's say I start subtracting 2, 2, 2, 2 from all the terms. Remember, the resulting sequence will also be an arithmetic progression with common difference. Can anybody tell me what is the common difference? Will common difference change? Yes, Ariaran, absolutely. Common difference will not change. It will still be the same. Okay. Because what is common difference? Common difference is the difference of subsequent minus the preceding, which is anyways not going to change because both are diminishing by the same or both are increasing by the same amount. If you multiply by a constant K, then the resultant sequence will also be in AP with common difference now as KD. With common difference as KD. Same goes with division as well. Okay. If you divide by non-zero quantity, this will still be in an AP with common difference as D by K. Okay. But very, very important thing. If you raise it to a power of k, let's say a1 to the power k, a2 to the power k, a3 to the power k, please note this will not be in AP. Okay. So 1, 2, 3, if I start raising it to a power of 2, so I get 1, 4, 9. This is not an AP because 1, 4 common difference is 3, 9, 4 common difference is 5. Okay. If you start taking their log, they will not be in AP. If you start raising them to a constant, they will not be in AP and so on. Okay. Anyways. And let's say there is another AP B1, B2, B3, da 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 da, with common difference as D dash. With common difference as D dash. Any question anybody has? Sir, is there any such square progression? We definitely have a progression where there are squares of numbers, but we cannot call that as arithmetic progression, right? Arithmetic progression should have that basic characteristic that the difference of subsequent minus the preceding should be fixed. Of course, we have squares of terms available, and we know how to find their sums out, and if we know their nth term, but they will not be called APs. Okay, so here we are talking about them being APs, arithmetic progression. Okay. Now, remember the fact that if you add two APs, let's say A1 is added to B1, A2 is added to B2, A3 is added to B3, da 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 da. This will still be an AP. Okay. With common difference being D plus D dash. Okay. Similarly, if you subtract them, I'm doing it in the same go so that we don't have to write it. That will be again in an AP with common difference as D minus D dash. Okay. But however, if you multiply them, please note they will be not in AP. Okay. Same goes with if you divide them, they will not be in AP. So one AP divided by another, or one AP terms divided by the terms of another AP will not be in AP. Okay, please remember this. Okay. I think second property we already did. We are going to third property now. So please allow me to change the slide. If you want to copy it, please do so. Yes, Akash, a reciprocal of arithmetic progression is what is geometric, is harmonic progression. We'll talk about it when we do harmonic progressions. Done, Anurag, and others, those who are copying. Done, sir. Anurag? Yes, okay, thank you, Anurag. Let's move on to the next. Third property is the choice of terms. So how do we choose terms in AP, especially when we know something about their sum? Okay. Now this is with a disclaimer that this is a preferred way of choosing the terms. Let me not brainwash you here that it is the only way to choose a term. No, it is a preferred way to choose a term. So if somebody asks you to choose three terms in AP, so if you want to choose three terms or three numbers which are in AP, then preferably you should choose it like A minus D, A and A plus D. Okay. It's not that if you choose it as A, A plus D and A plus 2D, your answer will not come. Nothing like that. But if you choose it like this and you have an information about the sum of these numbers, then you can easily find out A. Because as you can see, when you add them, the D vanishes, right? So 3A will be that sum given to you. So your A can be easily be found out. So especially where there is an information regarding the sum of the numbers, you should always go, or preferably go rather, with A minus D, A and A plus D as the numbers. Okay. If you have to choose four terms in AP, again, you should preferably go with A minus 3D, A minus D, I'm sorry, A minus D, A plus D, and A plus 3D. As you can see here, again, also these terms are so written that they are balanced out. So if you add them, D's will get cancelled off. And the common difference is no longer D in this case. The common difference here actually becomes 2D. But D is just a name, right? Don't be like so hardwired that D has to be a common difference. No, D is just a name which is used. Okay. So here 2D is a common difference. What big deal? Correct. If you have to choose five terms in AP, preferably, again, word preferably, you should use it, you should choose A minus 2D, A minus D, A, A plus D, A plus 2D. Okay. If you have to choose six terms in AP, you should preferably go for A minus 5D, A minus 3D, A minus D, A plus 3D, A plus 5D. Okay, da 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 da. I hope you have you can see the trend here. The trend is these guys will follow each other and these guys will follow each other. So let's say if you want to write down the seventh term, just take fifth term and write one term to the left, one term to the right. So seven terms will be created. If you want to write eight terms, take the sixth term guy, put one more term to the left, one more term to the right. So you'll have A minus 70 and here A plus 70, like that. Okay. So this can go on and on. Let's take questions on this. Let's take questions. Very easy question. I mean, probably you would have seen this question millions of times in your schools also. Just a warm-up question. The sum of three numbers in AP is minus 3 and their product is 8. Find the numbers. I'm just going to give you 60 seconds for this, not more than that. It's a super easy question. Oh, wonderful. I've got the answers. Some people. Gayatri, I don't know what is A, what is D. It is your call. You are calling something as AD, which is totally unaware to me. So I just want the three numbers. Very good. Okay, let's do this. So again, if you're asked to find, take three numbers which are in AP and know, you know their sum, okay? Then preferably take them as these numbers, right? So what are the benefit? Benefit is when you add them and equate it to minus 3, immediately you get the value as A, which is minus 1, okay? So you know your numbers are minus 1 minus D, minus 1 and minus 1 plus D. Now their product is 8. So if you multiply them, you'll get something of this nature. So this is nothing but minus 1 square minus d square. So which is 1 minus d square. And this is 8. So d square is equal to 9. So d could be plus minus 3. Okay. So there are two arithmetic progressions possible with this. So if you take a plus 3, your answer would be minus 4 minus 1 and 2. And if you take a minus 3, your answer would be exactly ulta. 4 minus 2, minus 1 and minus 4. Okay. Nevertheless, this is not going to change the three numbers, which are going to be still minus 4, minus 1 and 2. Okay. But if they ask how many APs are possible, okay, then you have to say two APs are possible in this case. Okay. Remember, APs need not always have D as positive. You can have a negative DAP as well. Is this fine? Any questions, any concerns? All right, so before we move on to GP, I would like to do one more question with you. One more question. Yeah, there you go. An AP consists of even number of terms 2n having middle terms. So there are two middle terms, of course, because there are even number of terms. So middle terms are 1 and 7 respectively. If n is the maximum value which satisfies this inequality, find the value of the first term. Okay. Let's start the poll. Let's have around 3 and a half minutes for this. Time starts now. Read the question properly before you start working it out. Very good. One person has responded. Anurag, what happened? Yeah. I'm sure you would have done something wrong. Last 1 minute. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, cool. Take a call. I mean, just take a guess. If at all you are not able to solve it, take a guess. You should also check how accurate you are if you take a guesswork. Okay, B is the most preferred guesswork which people take. Okay, somehow B is the safe haven for people who want to take a guess. Most of you have gone with B, by the way. Okay, let's check whether B was correct or not. See, first of all, if you have two n terms, what are the positions of the middle terms? So it is very obvious that the middle terms would have been tn and tn plus 1. Am I right? Right? Let's say there were 8 terms. So the middle term will be the fourth and the fifth term, isn't it? Correct? Yes or no? Let me write it. See, T1, T2, T3, T4, T5, T6, T7, T8. So these two will be the middle terms, isn't it? Okay. So if there are two n terms, middle term will be nth and n plus 1th term, right? So one thing is for sure that this is 1 and this is 7. Okay. So Tn plus 1 is known, and therefore T1 plus T2n will also be known, and that is nothing but 8. Not only that, that common difference is also known to us is 6, isn't it? What is common difference? Common difference is n plus 1th term minus nth term. Take any two consecutive term, succeeding minus preceding is common difference. So few things I came to know about this sequence or about this arithmetic progression. Number one, some of the first and the last term, which is T1 plus T2n, is going to be 8. Okay. And common difference is 6. Common difference is 6. Okay. So I can say one more thing here. T2n minus T1 would have been 2n minus 1 into 6. Correct? Anybody has a doubt with this information? Okay. Now, I'm planning to use these two to generate T1 into T21. So you can see here, there is a product of T1 into T2n. So I'm planning to use 1 and, sorry, this is 2. 1 and 2 for that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to square them. I'm going to square them and add them. So if I square this, I'll get Tn minus... Not add them, just subtract them. Subtraction makes more sense. Okay, so square them, subtract them. That means you're doing 64 minus 36 2n minus 1 square. If you see this, this will give you 4 T1, T2N. Am I right? Correct me if I'm wrong. Okay. And this is giving you 64 minus 36, 2N minus 1 square. Drop the factor of 4. This will be 16. This will be 9. Okay. Now, as per the question, T1, T2N plus 713 is greater than or equal to 0. That means 16 minus 9, 2N minus 1 square plus 713 is greater than or equal to 0. What does it mean? 729 minus 9, 2N minus 1 whole square is greater than or equal to 0. Drop the factor of 9. 81 minus 2N minus 1 whole square is greater than or equal to 0. Which is nothing but 2n minus 1 whole square minus 81 is less than or equal to 0. 81 could be written as 9 square. Right? So use a square minus b square formula. So a square minus b square will become a plus b and a minus b. Correct? If you want, you can drop the factor of 2 from everywhere. Yeah. So this means your n should lie between minus 4 to 5. I'm sure all of you know your inequalities. We have done so much of problems. So the question is saying that your n is the maximum value which satisfies this inequality. Means n is going to be 5. Okay. This is basically an attempt by these people to make this question slightly more difficult. Okay. This topic is already easy. So how to make it difficult? Do all these inequality ghusa do, dal do usme, right? It will become difficult, right? People will start, you know, making mistakes here. So see, JE problems are like that only. What they will do is they will give you, you know, 5 different things from where you will fetch the result to, you know, get the final answer. So if you make a mistake in any one of those 5 things, you are gone. So as a result, one problem will help them to test you on 5 skills or 5 concepts. Okay. That's how JE problems are normally framed. So if n is 5, that means you know there are 10 terms. Okay, there are 10 terms. Now, my question is find T1. How will I do that? Okay, let's find it out. So I know T1 plus T10 is 8. Okay, that means I know T1 plus 9 into 6 is 8. That means 2T1 is 8 minus 54, which is minus 46. So T1 value is minus 23, my dear. Chanta, option D is correct, not B. Okay. How many people voted for D? Let me check. Only 2 people. Who are they? Don't say, sir, me, sir. I was the person. Let's be honest. What was my theory? Oh, people answering me. Yeah. Anurag has a question. So wouldn't it be better if we add 1 and 2? Added 1 and 2. See, that also would have got. But my problem was here. I wanted to get my n value from this. Right? So that's why I wanted to generate. Your T1 into T2N in terms of N. That was my concern here, Anurag. If let's say that process helps you, please go ahead and try to see whether you are able to find out. I think you'll be stuck with T1 and N in the variables. Because one of the variables, T1 or T2N, will stay in the system. No. N will also be unknown. T2N will also be unknown. So how will you find, two variable inequalities from a single equation? That would be difficult. Right, Anurag? See, what you're saying, if you add them, you get 2t2n, right? 2t2n plus 713. And on the right-hand side, you'll end up getting a term in n. So there'll be two variables involved. T2n and n will be involved. So single inequality will not help you to find that answer. Okay. All right, yes. So we'll now go on to geometric progression. I'm sure you would all like to take a break right now.